Welcome, everybody. I guess it's good afternoon. My name is Patrick Flynn. I'm the head of the Advanced Programs Group and Intelligence Organization with Trellix Labs. We're based out of Columbia, Maryland, and we provide that sort of keep everybody left a boom type support from our company. It's so good to be back in San Francisco face to face. It seems like such a long time ago when we started planning this panel. It was back in December. And then based on the vid, you know, we got pushed back to June, and the whole world between now and then kind of turned upside down with the conflict in Ukraine. And we'll get into a little bit of that coming up. Surprising dynamics, you know, from the threat perspective, but we have wonderful panelists represent the NSA, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, and DHS CISA. I'd like to start off by some quick introductions, and we're gonna start with Erin. Erin Shepley works as the chief of the partnerships office within the Joint Cyber Defense Collaborative, AKA the JCDC. Erin's work carries across governmental partners and national boundaries and critical infrastructure sectors. She has worked for DHS for over 12 years supporting the cybersecurity mission, and she looks amazingly young to be there so long. Our next guest is Special Agent Scott Hellman with the Federal Bureau of Investigation. He has been investigating criminal and national security cybercrime for 13 years. He currently heads up a cyber investigation team out of the San Francisco field office. He holds a degree in chemistry, and he currently holds a Juris Doctorate. And then finally, NSA's own Natalie Pittore. Natalie served for 10 years in the Air Force as a Chinese language analyst. She served as NSA's first chief of cyber communication and now serves as the director of the Enduring Security Framework within the agency's Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. Fun fact about Natalie, she's a Halloween junkie. And number two, she shares a passion along with me. She loves to golf.
Pat knows too much about me.
That's good. That's good. Anyway, I'd like to start off with the first question, and I think I will come to Natalie first because I think her organization really, really does some good work. But if we could talk about what you do, what you lead, what's important to you, your organizational priorities, and you can have as long as you want.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. But I know it's only a 50-minute panel. Yeah. So first, thank you so much. It's such a privilege to be able to be here, but also to be able to sit a panel with some really incredible people. As Pat mentioned, we've been excited for this for quite a few months, and to actually be able to be here it's so refreshing to see everyone together. And really, I think when we talk about what this mission means to us at NSA, RSA almost embodies that in a sense, right? I have the privilege to be able to work at our Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. And for me, it is an embodiment of how NSA's cybersecurity mission continues to evolve. It's moving into this space with public-private partnership. And specifically, I lead an effort called the Enduring Security Framework, which is in part with our CISA partners. And it is an incredible opportunity to see experts and leaders from our defense industrial base, our communications, our IT sectors, coming together with our government partners and being able to say, here's a problem, now we're going to solve it, right? It's a little, you know, vanilla ice for you. But we really do work together and bring all aspects of what we have to the table, because what we've realized is it's the only way that we can make this work, right? Is if we're all sharing information and we're taking as many unknowns out of the picture as possible, because that's really where our strength lies. And so being able to do that as part of our collaboration center, being able to do that in partnership with CISA and FBI and our other partners, but then when you add that extra special element of our industry partners, that's really where I think we're seeing a difference, and it's such an exciting mission to be a part of.
Yeah, it was really interesting on the run-up to Ukraine. I think you and DHS and actually FBI were very, very helpful in the run-up to the event itself. We in industry, I feel, got a lot of good, really heads up, and we really began working together in a very efficient manner, and I'd never seen that before. Moving over to Erin a little bit, Walk us through what the JCDC is for those in the room that haven't heard about it, and what your priorities are from CISA perspective.
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. After lunch crowd, hopefully people didn't have too many beers at lunch. So we'll be watching your eyeballs and your foreheads, making sure they don't dip. But if you've worked with DHS, you're probably familiar with that. A lot of what we do is collaborative. A lot of what we do is public-private partnership. But really launching the Joint Cyber Defense Collaborative was trying to take that to the next level. So how can we go beyond building trust and sharing information to actually expanding the federal government's visibility of threat actors, to expanding the threat, the visibility the federal government has of vulnerability activity. So we're really trying to look at, you know, we're a mouthpiece for the nation, we're a mouthpiece for many organizations around cybersecurity, around best practices. A lot of organizations use us for watch and warning. How can we take that role and the tools, the technology, and the capabilities that we see across the private sector and really better understand what's going on in the ecosystem? So it's been a really awesome, exciting 10 months. So that's, you know, since Black Hat of last year is when we first kicked off. Excited to talk about some of the successes that we've seen, but it's growing and excited to be a part of it.
Thank you. And over to Scott. You know, what's neat about Scott is he actually investigates, you know, the mission stuff. He actually puts bad guys behind bars, or tries to. And he's based out of the San Francisco field office. But it from your perspective, as you look strategically across the threat intelligence landscape, what do you see as the most serious thing that resonates with you as an investigator?
Well, certainly ransomware has ballooned in the last many years, but I think on a much more basic level, imagine for a minute, it's right after lunch, you're sitting at your desk, it's probably very similar to what you are now. You got your coffee in front of you because you're trying to stay awake, and you get a phone call, and it sounds something like this. Hey Pat, my name's Scott, I'm calling from HR, and we received a report that you have been posting racist statements on one of your social media pages.
No, I didn't.
Just think about that for a minute. How would that make you feel? It's a true story for a victim company that came to us. And I know how that would make me feel. Immediately, I'd be so myopically focused on, oh my gosh, this is a disastrous mistake. Something's gone wrong. This is a mistake. How do I get myself out of this? And of course, the response would be, well, look, it's probably just a mistake. But because the computer you're using is company property, of course, we have to take a look at it. And so here, click on this link. We're going to remote into your system and take a look at your computer to make sure we don't have any sort of evidence of this. And we're, you know, these things happen all the time, and we just have to investigate all of them. Well, of course, 5 hours later, when somebody realizes that this is not actually HR, it's too late at that point, and millions and millions of pieces of PII from millions of customers were gone. And so I bring up this story because as we see a more ubiquitous adoption of MFA across a wide range of different services, bad guys, of course, have to figure out how to get around multi-factor authentication. And so we see upticks in social engineering and SIM swapping, some of the more basic elements of getting around 2FA. And so I think, yes, ransomware, and yes, very specific threats, but the basics of bad guys getting around the more advanced security measures that we're putting in place.
So you in our run-up to planning this, you've said basically you really, really have to get back to basics. I mean, it starts at the very, very lowest user level. And I think, you know, and at Trellix, we're focused on XDR and intelligence-driven, you know, making your SOC more efficient, all that stuff. However, you know, it doesn't prevent, you know, Pat Flynn from clicking on a link and then, you know, executing whatever, you know, and it's very pervasive. Do you think it's just that simple?
Well, I mean, as everybody knows, security is never simple. It's always a multi-layered approach. But you've got to have your core basics in check as best as you can. We saw 324,000 plus phishing attempts get reported to the FBI in 2021 alone. And some of the largest breaches that we saw throughout the year stemmed from password reuse, and social engineering to bypass multi-factor authentication attacks. I mean, from the most sophisticated companies that you can imagine, those basics have to be in check.
Very good, very good. Any other comments from your perspectives?
I certainly think that's a good start.
Yeah. Coming back to Natalie, it's interesting. Your collaboration work with the private sector has really been good over the last several years, at least as far as I've been around APG and been dealing with your org. You know, what do you see as the most valuable thing that industry brings in that collaborative?
You know, I think that's a good question, and you can answer it in a number of ways. But I think from watching how the collaboration has worked mm-hmm. over the last few years, it's bringing the people together and the shared experiences. So yes, the data is amazing, right? It's mm-hmm. nice to be able to say, well, I see this from my endpoints, and I see this from my signals intelligence. But it's when you bring these experts that have been working in this field, you know, and I think many of you are probably those people, right? Where you're like, I've followed this APT for the last 5 years. I know, you know, I looked at the attribution. I can predict its behavior. I watched how its TTPs evolve. It's all that richness you can't get into reports. It doesn't live just in the data. It's all that context that gets put around it. And so I think when you're bringing all these folks together and you're saying, let's focus on this common problem, right? We have a threat against the defense industrial base that we want, you know, we're unified by a common purpose. We're unified by this common goal. What do we have? What can we do about it? That creativity and innovation that really comes from it is what I see is that like secret sauce, like richness that's really coming from the work. And I think that's why we're seeing so much, you know, when it comes to our services, our advisories and everything coming out, because you have folks contributing there, you have all of that insight, that deep intelligence, that understanding, but it's that human side that goes over it, that puts it in context, that creates those creative actions and what we can do about it, that really, to me, is what's so unique and powerful about having this public-private partnership come together.
Yeah. Now, I bring the same question to you, Erin, from the JCDC perspective. Same mission, a little bit different flavor, and maybe on company makeup and stuff like that, but maybe represent how you guys all work together. Literally, I see you around the same tables all the time, ESF meetings, JCDC meetings, Natalie's there and all that sort of thing. How do you see it as what the private sector does well for you, for those
situations? I'll put it in two contexts. I'll put it in the day-to-day. So if you've worked with us, you'll know that we actually don't really work a lot in the intelligence space. We're very focused on the information that we get, not only from the federal's civilian executive branch, but also the work that we do. We deploy teams, we get information back. But really the critical thing that we get from private sector is they own the internet backbone, right? They have the visibility, they have the tooling. So when we're working on something and something piques our interest, it's a level setting. It's a way of sensing to understand what's going on in the ecosystem and the amount of calories that we need to put into it. How can we assess risk? And we as CISA, an organization responsible for kind of engaging all partners, big and small, government and non-government, and give them the best advice on what they should do. I think from a bigger event standpoint, so we could talk about a few of them, but I'll just mention quickly around the invasion of Russia to Ukraine. It was also that sensing work in the very beginning. So part of our partnerships work, we're not only working with private sector, I mentioned this a little bit, we work with federal government, state and local government, but also international partners. So we had a relationship with CERT Ukraine. So in early days, when we saw the targeted denial of service attacks going on, we were able to get those indicators of compromise around those attacks, share them with private sector, and quickly assess, you know, are any of these targets coming towards the United States? Are they targeting our financial sector? What's going on here? And we wouldn't have been able to do that work without the private sector. So that's just one example of many in that particular instance where it was critical that we use their tooling, their technology, and their visibility to understand what impact we were going to see domestically.
Well, and this is one anecdotal comment to both of your organizations. Over the last 3 years, you've probably done more collaborative work that's been effective, including more people in those organizations that I've ever seen. And I go back about three administrations between my time at DHS and working with you all. Shifting gears a little bit back to the BUs standpoint, you know, when I see this Venn diagram between criminal, nation state, and advocacy, adversaries like Anonymous and stuff like that, maybe not necessarily, you know, a criminal group, but I see them blending together a little bit. It's kind of hard to distinguish. I've just, from an investigator's standpoint, love to get your point of view on that and how you tackle that sort of thing. How do you distinguish?
Well, for one, you'd have to look at, we certainly look at, what are your motivations? What are your actors' motivations? What are they interested in? Are they interested in money? Are they interested in information? And what are they gonna do with that information? So for example, on the nation state side, typically you're gonna have an intelligence mission. You've got foreign adversaries who are interested in collecting and just collecting and collecting and collecting, and they wanna stay low and slow, and they wanna be quiet, and they don't wanna get caught. Whereas you go completely in the opposite from the ransomware side, time on network is gonna be like 25 days at most, because they want to breach, pivot, encrypt, collect, and then let you know immediately so they can get paid. So that's a huge difference that we're gonna see in terms of what does the behavior look like. Mm-hmm. I think though there's certainly a blend where we see nation state actors who have a certain skill set may decide to do some side work, and you'll see that bleed out as criminal activity as well, where maybe after their time on network is not as important, you have, you know, theft of data that could be used for monetization that happens after the fact.
Yeah, nation state, you know, they're going to be sneaky. They're going to want to watch it for a little while, if not years. So, you know, totally makes sense. You know, knowing that the audience here is some governments and private sectors, you know, various different walks of life as far as industries are concerned, from the FBI's perspective, how do you advise them, or do you advise them at all with an investigation or some type of criminal event? How do you walk them through the process? You know, criminally, it's the incident response. You kind of explain your role in that.
Mm. So I think oftentimes there tends to be a bit of a disconnect in terms of what a victim company would expect from us. And I think ransomware is a pretty good example, where the typical paradigm is you've been hit by ransomware, so your network has been encrypted, you've got no comms, so you can't communicate with your people, you've got no payroll, so you can't pay your staff, and they pick up the phone and call us, and the expectation from them is, any show of hands, Harry Potter fans? The expectation is that we have the Elder Wand. For anybody who doesn't know what the Elder Wand is, it's the most powerful wand in the entire wizarding world. And so the expectation is that we can show up and, like, decrypt your data, and then post-colonial pipeline, the expectation now is, oh, and if we've paid the ransom, the Bureau can get it back. That happened one time, once. It's not very common. And then the further expectation is we can help maybe remediate your network. In reality, of course, our job, our mission is investigation. It's part of our acronym. And so more realistically, if you are a victim, the interaction with us should be really twofold. One, it should be like the now, right? We're just meeting each other, developing a rapport, developing a relationship, so that if something does happen, you know who to call. Or also, we oftentimes, whether it's us deriving it or working with our partners, come across intelligence that could suggest, we think that we see this IP address on your network is pinging out to this, whatever it is, let's say a C2 node, that indicates that maybe it's a precursor for ransomware. So it would be great if I had a person that I can call and let you know ahead of time, hey, this is an issue and you might want to take a look at it. So that's one place where the relationship is going to form, is before an issue happens. But if it's on the back end and we're just meeting, we're going to be there we feel for you. Our job is to collect information from you so that we can try and identify who, typically in cyber, it's always who done it. We know something happened. We know something got taken or breached. We don't know who did it. So we want to collect that data from you so that we can figure out that answer to that question, who did it, and see if we can go stop them, slow them down, impose some sort of a cost.
And those familiar with the IR process, oh, by the way, it's attorney-client privilege information. No one's going to want to talk about it, you know, at least till it's ironed out. You brought up Colonial Pipeline. We're not going to talk about Colonial Pipeline, but it put an idea in my head, and I'm going to take this to you, Erin. You know, log4j, big deal. How do you grade out DHS, CISA on the response? Same question to you and the same question to him. You know, walk us through that. It seemed from an outsider perspective looking in, it went pretty well. Yeah, I think it was effective, but I'd love to get your two cents.
Yeah, I think despite it ruining some of our holidays and continuing to surprise us, and I'll give kudos because some of the folks that worked it are in this room, but it was really an innovative approach. And I don't know if you guys know this, but the team and one of our sister brother organizations where I work put up a public-facing website so that organizations could go out there and see if any of the software or hardware that they run was susceptible or vulnerable to Log4j, right? We had really never done something like that. And also, some of our friends from the Netherlands had done something similar, so not only did we have two repositories, but we made sure that they were seamless. So the Dutch put something up, it gets cross-posted on ours, and vice versa. That was great from like a public standpoint. Behind the scenes, it was kind of similar to what I mentioned before, where we were trying to track, you know, what adversaries are looking at exploiting this, what sectors are being targeted, how do we continue to monitor it? And now it's transitioned to how do we keep people paying attention to something that happened months ago but is still a problem? So kind of using some of those examples and showcasing them. But it was one of our first really early trials, if you will, mm-hmm. of the new JCDC construct, and I thought, you know, the team really hit it out of the park, and it was really a great collaborative way to bring so much benefit to a global audience.
And I think that building on what Erin said and something that Scott mentioned that's important is you can't be making friends in a crisis, right? Yeah. And so I think what we've done here over the past few years is to create that ecosystem where we are, those relationships are in place, the trust is constantly evolving. So when you do get hit with something that's completely out of left field and you're like, okay, what are those innovative approaches? How are we gonna posture to be able to respond to something so critical? You're working with people that you know. It's like, okay, hold on, I need to call so-and-so. We need to get this out. Okay, who do we have, you know, those calls that you're like, let me reach out to CISA, let me talk to my folks at FBI. It's, we are now in a place where that's so much, that muscle memory is there, and I think that that's something that we're seeing continue to build, and it's making this more manageable across the board for all of us in these moments of crisis, right?
And to build on that, I would say we understand each other's expertise too, right? We kind of like know what role we play and the value we can bring to the table. We're not trying to be the person that solves the problem, but we're all kind of bringing what we bring best.
What's really nice from a personal perspective is you call us. You know, if you have a problem, a hard problem, you actually physically call us, get us on the Slack channel, whatever. That's neat, by the way, you know, being able to communicate with you directly. And if you have some critical piece of information that you need to brief us on privately, you make that available. And we've never seen that before in the past. It's always been real close hold, and for obvious reasons, sourcing and all that sort of stuff. From the FBI's perspective, Log4j, how did you see it from the field office perspective?
From the field perspective, we were really looking at it, to be honest, from a very reactive standpoint. It was, well, there's a lot of people out there that are vulnerable. There's a tremendous amount of messaging that's going out from various different partners. And so I don't know, at least from the field office perspective, we were not about to be duplicative and continue to push the same narrative. We could at least point, if people had questions, we could point them to, you know, any number of different products that had come out. And really, we're just going to handle it from a reactive standpoint, that if there is a victim, then, you know, that cyber actor could be anybody, and we're going to treat it sort of like any other case.
Sounds good. Erin, you know, we talked about nation state criminal actors and stuff like that, and you guys build pretty good cyber advisors. You want to walk us through what's available to the public and the private sector as far as that's concerned through your organization?
Yeah, so I think a good example, I already mentioned the work we did around the invasion and war in Ukraine. You might be familiar, we launched a Shields Up webpage. We took a lot of the materials associated with Russian government sponsored actors and co-located it. For what it's worth, all of that work was already co-located, but then we were also adding some advisories and resources from the private sector. Again, kind of going back to that point that we're not the only person that knows about this, nor are we the ones that are going to solve the problem, but a lot of our coworkers across industry were the first out of the gate when, you know, Hermetic Wiper and Isaac Wiper came out, had really great articles. Those were getting posted there as well. So we've tried to consolidate things. I think Shields Up was a great effort, not only to draw awareness to, you know, our fear and concern that there might be retaliatory attacks against U.S. Critical infrastructure or government, but to put it in a place where it's like easily consumable, easy to find, and everything is located there from government and private sector.
We see your organization, we see the JCDC, and recently DNI was setting up a similar organization. How do you avoid crossing swords in that collaborative, if you will, because, you know, each one of those organizations are doing it a little bit differently. How do you coordinate internally against all three of your organizations, and now DNI's in the same game?
Yeah, so, well, first, I think in some areas, right, at the Cybersecurity Collaboration Center, we have our clear mission set, right? We're protecting the DIB and national security systems, and so that is a major priority for us. So you can go on NSA.gov, you can see the services we have to offer, and those are, you know, we push that information out to make it as available. But I think at the end of the day, it comes down to communication and working together and knowing, you know, okay, this is something, like, I personally lead a project that is, I talk to my CISA counterparts daily, right? It's like, that's part of the way that we live our mission is as a joint team. And so as early on, and you're seeing it, right, with more joint advisories and how we're working together, it's really where we're pooling all of those resources together and knowing one another so that you aren't duplicating. You know, it's, okay, what's my role in this? Where can I lend expertise? How can I help? Where's the best place to promote, to place this, right? So it really comes down to us working together day in and day out.
What's your perspective from the JCDC?
That was so well said. I feel like I have nothing to add.
Oh, but you have.
Yeah, I mean, it's really, I'm just going to repeat what she said. It's understanding the roles and responsibilities each of the people play, and that goes for private sector too. So within the JCDC, it's a fusion of government partners and private sector partners. We all have a role to play, and it's making sure that we can complement each other and not duplicate.
So, you know, from the Collaboration Center perspective, you've been really busy over the last 2 years. You've established the organization, you've built a beautiful building. I could actually walk into this building with my own laptop, plug into their Wi-Fi, use my cell phone, you know, but if you have to walk into a SCIF, you can. And it's a wonderful organization. They gave me a coffee cup too.
They
that
did,
was cool.
Yeah.
But what's next? You know, beyond that, being able to be more collaborative, what other good ideas do you guys
have? Oh boy, what's next? Really, you know, we're looking at this at how do we scale, right? Mm-hmm. The DIB is huge. The numbers that of just how many, you know, entities there are to protect and the threats that are coming at it. So we're constantly trying to revisit of, okay, where can we have that most effective outcome? Like where should we be applying that weight so that we're affording the opportunity for us, you know, our ecosystem to be protected. And that comes in different things, right? It's working with small and medium-sized businesses, mm-hmm. and being mindful when we're releasing information and when we're working on mitigations that it's who's consuming it. Are we making it so that everyone has a fair shot at defending themselves? I mean, we're building, we're expanding. You can come see me at the booth, the NSA booth, if you'd like a job. We're always recruiting talent. So there's just so much opportunity because the challenges are there, right? Like the threat's not going away anytime soon. Our technology is getting more complex. There's so many places to go. It's doing that rigorous prioritization and then, you know, bringing the right people in to team and solve the problems.
Is there anything on the horizon from CISA's perspective?
Yeah, I think, you know, we had some great, well, I shouldn't call them great experiences. They're really terrible experiences that were great and that we learned things. But it's really taking what has become an evolved, like, information fusion model and really moving into defense. Like, how can we do collective defense? it's not just our responsibility, it's not just your responsibility. How can we look at like collaboratively talking about a threat actor and who they're targeting and defend against that? And that's new and hard and complicated. You mentioned Slack. Slack has been instrumental in helping us ease the burden of, you know, we don't need email and we don't need calls. We can quickly share information. Mm-hmm. But I think taking it to the next step where we can, you know, set a cyber defensive plan, action the actions, and collectively as public and private sector defend critical infrastructure is going to be an amazing but difficult next step.
One of the things, you know, organizationally within what I do, we understand that not every organization can afford, you know, really awesome risk analysis and keep me a left of boom like a bank or a large governmental institution. One of the priorities from my perspective and that of Trellix is the fact that we're trying to push it out to the small guy, the medium-sized person, you know, that critical information so they can contextually wrap their arms around what the problem is, agnostically, you know, not just because you got Trellix in there, it's just because our data, which is coming in from several different sources, can inform you much more broadly. So that's one of the priorities from the company's perspective. One of the things I wanted to ask you, I see a lot of communication coming out of DHS, CISA on vulnerabilities and stuff like that. It's very nice. I love that stuff because we can take that information, we push it down analytically to our advanced research organization and create a better MISP instance internally. You know, how's that, you know, is that from your perspective working effectively? I think it is. I think what you collaboratively put out between the three organizations also is very good, but kind of walk us through your vulnerability perspective.
Yeah, so I had an interesting role before this role where I worked predominantly with federal civilian executive branch, and we found that we were dealing with a vulnerability a week, that we had to get all of 102 federal agencies on a call and talk about exposure and what mitigation actions, and we were all getting real burned out. And we're like, how can this be a lot better? So some of my colleagues, you know, we wrote up a new measure that resulted in the known exploited vulnerability database, which is public, and again, a very global and well-received action where people can track that and helps them prioritize what their vulnerability management plan should look like. But that was just one of the critical ways that we started to take something that was an organizational issue, not just for us, but across the board, and simplify the way that we manage that.
That's a good answer, and I just wanted to put it out to the general audience. When we get into a situation like Log4j or any other, or whatever you're dealing with, we have an organization that studies, researches vulnerabilities, and you know it's just pure research. But what was nice on Log4j specifically, we were able to bring, and you don't have to pay for this, by the way. And we can come in and we can show you what happened, you know, very methodically, exactly what happened. You know, recently we briefed you on the Linux, which is going to go public here at the event back east. But, you know, those types of organizations that actually investigate ICS type vulnerabilities are very effective. So if you ever have a question, if you ever are curious or scared to death, give us a call. You know where, well, get my number and I can lead you to the right person. Another question for Erin is, walk us through, I believe it's 22.1, the BOD, the Binding Operational Directive.
Yeah, that's kind of what I mentioned. And so if you're not familiar with this, the way the federal government works, DHS has the ability to mandate the federal agencies take any sort of corrective action. It could be response, like in SolarWinds, to a known incident, an adversary activity to evict the actor, or it could be just best practices, which is kind of really what this one is, which is around the mitigation of known exploited vulnerabilities. So, and I think the other thing I'll add to that is what we've seen is when we send these things out, obviously the principal focus was originally on the federal government, but they've been taken up by so many other partners across the United States. So state and local governments often take these and kind of establish them as benchmarks. These are the kind of practices I should keep. This is good cyber hygiene. We get a lot of uptick internationally on a lot of these directives. So anytime we issue them, yes, it has a singular mandated purpose, but what we end up seeing is that it has cascading effects and kind of setting standards for the rest of the community.
And do you have a like a website or something that people can go to if they're interested in reading up on it?
Yeah, so everything's under our CISA.gov website. It should be fairly easy to navigate to. I, too, will be at the DHS booth at the expo. And also, we are recruiting. Hopefully, we're not dueling, like you're across and they're like tearing people back and forth. But if anyone has trouble accessing any of that, I'm happy to point them in the right direction. But everything's under our main webpage.
I'm going to come back to you Scott, and this will be the final question before we get into Q&A. What's new for the FBI? You know, what's your vision organizationally? One way or the other, anything new or exciting? Or
I think one thing that's amazing about cyber investigations is it's constantly new. Mm-hmm. It's constantly evolving. We've seen an enormous increase in crypto-related thefts, crypto-related crimes. There's, you know, it's such a new space. There's new companies being birthed all the time. And so we certainly are seeing, you know, going back, let's say 10 years or 15 years, it was a lot of the tech companies that were going through growing pains that are now have this very, very mature security posture. And of course, those new companies that are starting now, they don't have that mature security posture yet. And so they're dealing with those issues now. And so I certainly see a lot in the crypto space. And so as those new types of crimes pop up and adversaries are using, you know, more and different obfuscation techniques, mm-hmm. we're constantly having to evolve, figure out how do I solve for X now and now and now. And so it never feels like, okay, what's the next big frontier? It's like every other day is some other new problem that you have to figure out how to solve.
I have another question.
Sure.
That you just reminded me of. We deal with cryptocurrencies, you know, the tracing of which and stuff like that. Some of them are a little bit better than others. You know, what's the right answer? Regulation, policy, you know, how do we better enable how we trace that to recover ransoms and that sort of thing?
That's a great question.
And it could be a Scott Hellman response, not a Bureau response. Yeah.
There's a wide range of issues, of course, because it's not like this is an issue that is in a United States bubble, mm-hmm. right? We've got to, I think the answer is we've got to understand what it is that people are doing with it and what the uses are and continue to work with our foreign partners. I mean, there's I don't have a magic answer for that one. I feel like it's a bee's nest I'm about to step into. So,
it's about, you know, recovering money and stuff like that. And you're absolutely right. You know, we can regulate it all day long. All they're going to do is go somewhere else. So it's got to be a global response. And I think, you know, if we were sitting here in front of Congress or something, we would reaffirm that same stance. If we're going to do it, we're going to do it together as a global presence to be able to regulate it in some form or fashion, to be able to go after the money that's illegitimately, you know, famoosed. With that, I'll open it up to questions. There's mics. He's got a question.
Yeah. It better not be.
I know that guy. Yeah. Go ahead, sir.
All right. So, thank you. That was really insightful. Very quick question as it relates to the CISA Known Exploited Vulnerabilities Catalog, right? So, I think this is an incredible tool to know what's being actively exploited. But as practitioner, it's not always obvious how to actually acquire the IOCs to detect those attacks happening on our networks. So, is there any intent to go and expand toward these things?
Yeah, there is. So there is a methodology that we use to help score vulnerabilities. And obviously, we're focusing on a subset of vulnerabilities because we can't put all of them in there. But there is absolutely an intent to make this a little S standard, where we all kind of are able to score and rank and assess vulnerabilities the same way. Actually, the colleague that owns and manages that is sitting in the back. So if you want to do a sidebar with him, you can.
Just raise your hand.
He raised his hand. Yeah. There he is.
I see him.
I'm sure he'd be happy to entertain that.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question. We'll come over here to the gentleman in the blue.
Hi, thanks. You're talking about collaborating across government agencies and then with industry organizations that have different cultures and missions and work at different speeds and have different needs and approach things differently. Can you talk about how you got from that collection to what sounds now like kumbaya, everybody's working in the right direction, working together hand in hand? How did you make that happen?
I don't think it's kumbaya yet. I think we've taken a step beyond. If I was to really bluntly translate what I think public-private partnership used to be, was just trust brokering, right? I share a little bit with you, you share a little bit with me, maybe it's beneficial, maybe it's not, but now I kind of trust you. And I feel like I've seen it evolve to us solving problems together, which is a lot more difficult. One of the things that I mentioned before that I think is a challenge is the way that government looks at countering threat actors and how private sector looks at countering threat actors is different. And that's something that it isn't kumbaya yet, and we're gonna have to work to figure out how we can speak the same language and address it in unison.
I know when we do research, we don't sit on it. You know, when we do research, we don't sit on it. If we know it's going to affect someone, we write up a very thorough analysis of it. But you know, we make sure people understand that it's potentially earth shattering. So from a company perspective, that's certainly how we handle it. Did you have?
Yeah, well, I don't know that it's ever going to be 100% kumbaya. I think there's always going to be an understanding that we all have different missions. On the private side, you're going to have different missions and interests. And the same thing on the Bureau side versus CISA or NSA. We all have varying different missions, and just being okay sometimes with understanding that we're running parallel, and we all sort of want ultimately some of the same things, but knowing where those overlaps are and understanding how we can work together on the overlapping pieces, and then also being okay with the fact that I'm also going to have to do my piece and you have to do your piece, and private industry is going to have their own piece. So it's understanding as well as being able to work together, and then understanding that we're also going to have to diverge at points.
Thank you.
Did that take care of you? Okay. Thank you for your question. Coming back over.
Hey, thanks, Patrick. So I'm going to try to drag you guys back to sort of the original title of this panel. Right, as government organizations, especially NSA, but really all three of you, you have access to intelligence information that's not available to the general public. How do you utilize that, or what do you think are the best ways to utilize that special sauce to help these public-private partnerships and actually eventually impose cost on adversaries?
Do you want to go? Neil, I think it's cheating for me to answer that. And I'm sorry, I have like crazy allergies right now, so I'm like dying. But I think what we're seeing is when we're bringing all that uniqueness together, right, it has to be to apply it to an actual purpose. Mm-hmm. So I look at what we're doing on the 5G security front, and when you have all of these stakeholders with different equities, and we're saying, you know, this is what I might see in the SIGINT, but this is what a company X might see as the technology is developing. It's where we can look at that full life cycle, but it's for the purposes of taking an action, right? Okay, so in order to do that, for us to be able to actually build more secure 5G infrastructure, we need to understand that full scope of the life cycle, bring it together, and then actually do something about it. And so I think that it's a matter of us looking at that uniqueness and having that trust and that open sharing to actually have it actually drive outcomes, right?
I'll comment directly, Neil. You know, and I'll go back to the run-up to the invasion, Ukraine. It was a wonderful experience, you know, because we started literally 6-7 months before even anybody started crossing any borders anywhere. I thought both DHS as well as the NSA was very, very proactive, very collaborative, and when they had an event that it was relevant and they needed to show the source material, they got the appropriate people from the private sector up in the SCIF. This is what's going on. FYI, use it the way you need to. But I thought that was very, very beneficial. They were very, very proactive when it came to that sort of thing. And did you have any other comments on that? Okay. And to you, ma'am.
Thank you. And it's great to be listening to such a wonderful panel. My question is on for critical infrastructure sites. You know, obviously, if an attack happens, time is of the essence. And I was wondering, what do you recommend in the first few hours that people at the site do? Who should they call? What should be their response in the first few hours and beyond?
You mind if I hop on that one? I would say it's what you're doing before those first few hours. It's having a disaster recovery plan that you practice probably on a regular basis, so that's where you have to ask that question. Because I don't know that there's any one right answer, but you've got to understand your own environment and have that disaster recovery plan in place. And then through those tabletop exercises, of which I'm assuming you guys as well, we all are happy to participate, or at least on the Bureau side, I don't want to speak for you, but are happy to participate in tabletop exercises with private industry. So to help you navigate through some of those questions that'll come up, when do we contact, whether it's law enforcement, when do we contact CISA, or what do we do in these types of situations? So that's where you're going to be able to answer those questions, is through your own practice and tabletops.
And to add to that, my selfish request is find a way to anonymize it and share it as soon as possible while the information is still helpful. So everyone, once they become a victim, shuts their doors and closes their windows and doesn't talk to anybody about it. And then 3 months later, we all see a blog about an incident that happened. But that's not helpful, right? Because by the time that blog comes out, it's already happened and the actor has moved over to new infrastructure. So my request is, you know, find a way to anonymize it so that we can identify, is this part of a broader campaign? Can we alert the rest of critical infrastructure to what this activity is? Because that's really when the most benefit's gonna happen. It's the hardest, no one wants to share during that period, but it's the most beneficial.
Thank you. Is that all?
Yeah.
Good. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am, please.
One question, Natalie.
Can you go to the mic?
For the enduring security framework, how do you know you're successful?
Oh, I think actually one indicator to me is our partners continue to want to do more work with us. So as we work through a new challenge, so if you take 5G, for example, you know, we all got together and said, we really need to dig into this threat space. And after we did that, it was like, everyone kind of looked up and we said, okay, what are we gonna work on next? All right, we're gonna look at cloud and risks in the cloud associated with 5G. So let's dig in. And then we completed that and
single sign-on.
And then next thing was, okay, what's next? Let's look at network slicing. Let's look at open radio access networks. Let's look at identity and access management. And so when you have the partners that are in, keep coming back to do more with you, I think that's an indicator, because they're seeing it, we're seeing it, and we're starting to see the dividends. I also will say, you know, we push our information out as much as we can publicly. And when you get the feedback from the consumers of it, this helped me, this is, you know, I took this, you know, actually the other day I was on a call with a CISO from a small DIB company, and he said, you know, I keep the top 10 security practices that NSA developed, it's hanging up at my desk. And I laughed and I was like, man, we released that in like 2018. He's like, it's still relevant. And he's like, I point it when I get a new employee, I give it to them. It's like one of their opening packages. And I was like, that's incredible. I was like, because, you know, you don't always get that, you know, positive affirmation that someone's using what you put out. But with being more open and sharing information, we're getting so much more in that feedback loop of, hey, do you think you could look at this? And with our partners, we'll say, hey, we want to solve this one problem. And they'll go, no, let's solve this bigger problem. And you're like, all right, let's do it, right? And so there's so much energy around it, and we're getting such great feedback from the community that to me, I think, that's a strong indicator that what we're doing right, and that we can continue to do more and more and more, right?
The organization is a really, a really, really solid, dates back to General Alexander. And it's really tackled really, really hard problems. The whole intent of it is to create solutions, something real. Mm-hmm. It's not policy focused, but something real that the private sector can utilize, and the DIB can utilize, the national security apparatus can utilize. It's good. I would highly recommend it. Apply for membership, you know, and stuff like that when it comes around. The term of office is it lasts a couple years, but it's very useful. And we're getting back to face-to-face meetings finally, and that's nice. But with that, we're at our time limit. I want to thank Natalie, Erin, and Scott for trucking all the way out here. I want to thank DHS, the NSA, specifically Rob Morgan, for lending us Natalie here. I appreciate that very much. And Scott, who weathered COVID over the last couple of weeks and was finally tested negative to be here today. And I appreciate you accepting the invitation. But if I could get everybody a round of applause for our guests.